I want to welcome everyone to How to Address Customer Objections in the Sales Cycle. We have Karen, Mavis, Monica, and Stacy from Zenagos. We're very pleased to have them giving this presentation to our SCORE clients. They give excellent presentations, so be prepared to learn a lot. So as we get going, I do want to make sure you know a little bit about SCORE so that you are getting the most benefit you can from our organization. Our goal is to share information with the small business community, and we do that in three main ways. One is through our website, score.org. You will find tons of information, templates you can download, articles you can read, videos you can watch, all kinds of great information. So if you haven't dug through the resource section on the website, take a look. The other way we share information is through our workshops and webinars. Most are in person or online. We do have occasionally a few in person. Those are advertised through our website. They're advertised through our newsletter and on social media. So if you're not following us, please do that. And you'll find out what's coming up next. We have a lot of great topics for the fall, and we're pleased to bring those to you. The other important task that SCORE has is providing free mentoring. And our mentors are volunteers, and they come to us with all different backgrounds and experiences, and they just simply want to give back to the small business community. And we're working with folks at all different stages, whether you're trying to decide if having a small business is right for you, if you're in that heavy planning phase, or already in business, we can help you. People come to us asking about many different business topics, many that you probably haven't even imagined, and we will work to find the mentor that can best assist you. A first session is going to be learning about you, learning about your goals and challenges, and then working on a plan to help you get there and help you overcome. Your primary mentor will often invite others, will often reach back to other mentors for additional advice to make sure you're getting everything you need in that moment. So how do you get a mentor? It's very, very easy. Score.org, blue box, there's a put in your zip code and it'll match you to the chapter that's nearest you. This is the easiest way. Then put a little, there's a information screen that comes up. They're going to ask you a little bit about how we can help you. The more information you provide there, the easier it is to match you to a person that can best assist you. So fill that out and we will reach out to you with some options for meeting with one of our mentors. So today's format, we are going to be using a Q&A for questions. We're going to take questions at the end. So if you think of anything along the way, put it into that Q&A tab or button on the Zoom bar, and we will get those addressed. Everything else can go into chat. Do not hesitate if you have a comment or something that you need addressed right away. We are recording, and we will post this recording on our website at score.org/Boston. You'll look under the local workshops on the blue bar and go down to the previously recorded webinar. Give me 24 to 48 hours to get that posted, but it'll be there for you to rewatch at your convenience. So I'm going to pull down my share and I'm going to introduce you to Karen from Zenagos.
Thank you, Teresa, for that kind introduction. We are very excited to be here today. I'm going to make sure that everybody can see my screen and then we'll get rolling. I'm Karen Baldischwiller. My colleagues call me K14, so they don't have to pronounce my crazy 14-letter Swiss last name. I'm one of the four co-founders of Zenagos. We call ourselves the Zenagos Experts, and we are all here today. We have extensive sales experience. So Monica is the master of complex deals involving combinations of private companies, nonprofits, and governments. As one example, she negotiated a ground lease for a $13 million public-private aviation project in North Carolina, last two. Stacy has advised branded companies, including Fidelity and Land's End, but she spent the last two decades helping a wide variety of small businesses to improve their marketing, sales, and technology. And Mavis has sold massive e-commerce technology deals to companies like Walmart and Nestle. but her coolest sales experience was selling Lexus cars for the highest rated dealer in the US, the winner of the 2022 JD Power of Excellence Award and many other years as well. I also have experience selling 10-year, eight-figure enterprise deals to big colleges like University of Kansas, the College of William and Mary. So we each have a lot of experience working in big companies. But what we're most proud of is that we have each started small companies, 17 small businesses between the four of us. We've each been a solo entrepreneur at least once in our lives, and we know how hard it is just to get a business off the ground. So now as Zenagos, we provide our blue chip experience to small businesses at a very affordable cost because we want others to get the help that we wish we'd had back then. And we're really thrilled to have an opportunity to share with and learn from you today. So first a few housekeeping items. So please feel free to engage in the chat. I'm going to give you some practice questions to answer in there as we go too. So keep an eye out for that. If you have questions, please put them in the Q&A window because at the end of the presentation, we'll answer as many of them as we can. We don't want them to get lost in the chat because the chat moves pretty quickly. So if you have a question you'd like us to answer at the end, please put it in the Q&A window. That way we'll see it. If you want to connect with one or more of us on LinkedIn after the session, please make sure to say that you are at the SCORE webinar. That way we will accept your invitation. And Stacey's going to put our LinkedIn links in the chat in case you want to connect with any or all of us. By the end of the session, you're going to be able to identify the different types of customer objections. You're going to understand why addressing an objection is important for closing the sale. And you're going to be able to describe the best way to address each type of objection. We're going to give you some awesome tips for each type of objection. We're also going to demonstrate addressing objections so that you just see how the whole conversation flows. And you don't need to worry about taking notes or screenshots because at the end of the presentation, we're going to give you a QR code and a link so that you can download the summary slides. So let's start by defining and identifying customer objections. If you're not confident about pitching your ideas or selling your offering, you're not alone. Most people find it challenging to describe their product or service, and many are afraid of selling. They might have some bad memories about pushy salespeople and they don't want to be that kind of person, or they might fear rejection. I mean, nobody really enjoys that. Addressing objections, it's a new concept for most people, so expect it to be a little awkward at first. And just remember, everyone can improve, and the way to get better is to practice. So let's do it. At Zenagos, we teach eight key steps for a sales conversation. These eight steps should flow naturally as a dialogue between you and your prospective customer. We cover these steps in greater detail in our workshop called Perfecting Sales Conversations, so keep an eye out for that one. And if you want to get early notice of any of our upcoming events, just go to the bottom of the Zenagos homepage and sign up for our newsletter. It only comes once a month and it always includes all of our upcoming free webinars. Stacey's going to go ahead and put the link in the chat for you for that one. So we refer to the first four steps in our process as opening the sales conversation and the last four steps as closing the sales conversation. So today we're going to focus on step five. We're going to do a deep dive into customer objections, which is the first and most challenging step in closing a deal. This is a normal and natural part of selling, the process of helping your prospective customer become comfortable with their decision to buy. It's also a part of the sales process where many small business owners experience challenges, especially entrepreneurs who don't have any previous sales experience or training. So what is an objection? An objection is anything that a potential customer says or thinks that might keep them from buying from you. So some objections are obvious, like that's too expensive, or I don't need that. Some objections are hidden, things that they think but don't say, such as I don't want them to find out about my bad credit, or they don't think I'm rich enough to be in this store. And then some objections are total brush-offs, such as I don't have time for this. Please don't call me again. When you receive objections, it's not a bad sign. It's not a reason to get defensive. It's just information. And when you get an objection, your customer's telling you you have more selling work to do. So for today, we're going to focus on objections that the customer shares with you, the obvious objections and the brush-offs. Surfacing hidden objections is a next level sales skill. We don't have time to cover that today, but if you master the framework that we show you today, it'll form the foundation for you to start surfacing hidden objections too. All right, in order to close most sales deals, you need to identify the objections and then you need to address them. And this becomes a cycle in which the prospective customer or prospect raises an objection, you address the objection, and then you confirm that you've addressed it. Once you've addressed all the objections, then you can move to the next step, which is asking for commitment. And often when you ask for commitment, the customer raises a new objection. That's okay. It's a normal part of the selling process. So when you get a new objection, you just do the cycle again. And you keep doing this within reason and nicely, of course, until the customer's run out of objections and is ready to commit. So sometimes you will run into an objection that you just can't address or resolve right then. And when that happens, you do have to jump off the cycle and schedule a follow-up. That's like a time or a date when you'll have the information necessary to resolve the objection. So we're going to talk about that too. So let's break this down. Step one is to listen for the customer's particular objections. So one of the challenges that new small business owners have when talking to customers is that we talk too much and too soon. We think our offering is awesome, obviously, and we really want to close the deal. And so we just start spewing information. We don't listen well enough. And this happens especially when we're nervous. However, good listeners are thought to be the best conversationalists. Why? Because people like to talk about themselves. So prospects will typically be happiest if they do most of the talking. Also, if you can keep your prospect talking, their objections will arise and then you can address them. If you talk too much, you might never even hear the objections. And if you don't hear them, you definitely can't address them. And that may keep you from winning the business. Another common mistake in sales conversations is to treat objections like a shooting gallery. So you identify them as quickly as possible and you shoot them down. Sometimes you shoot them down even before the prospect says it because you know what the objections are. So our advice, don't try to guess your customer's objections. Customers may expect this kind of an aggressive approach in some sales settings, but even then they really rarely enjoy it. You might be addressing objections that they don't really have, which is a waste of your energy, and it really makes them feel unheard. So once again, listen. Figure out what the prospect's top priorities are so that you can hear the objections. So the best salespeople take the time to build a relationship. Now, sure, yes, there are common objections, and you may know what they're going to be for your product, but every prospective customer is different, and so they might have a slightly different concern. And the only way you're going to figure out how to close a deal with this particular prospect is if you listen first and try to connect. So once again, stop talking and listen. One time I had a sales employee who was struggling and I told him that his motto needed to be JST, just stop talking. Because sometimes the best information comes after an uncomfortably long pause. All right, in preparation for the next section, let's take just a moment for reflection. So what objections have you heard frequently when selling your offering? What do prospects say or think that keeps them from buying from you? If you want to share some objections in the chat, please do. Make sure you choose everyone so that everybody can see your objections, that you're not just saying to the hosts and the panelists. At the very least, write them down for yourself. So take just a minute to write down what objections have you heard when people say they're not quite ready to buy, because you're going to want to have this list handy to refer to as we go through these types of objections. So I'm going to give you just a minute to do that. Can't afford it. The speed, always frustrating for a salesperson when you get, talk to me next month. We want to take the time to look at our options. Always frustrating. I can get a better price from your competitor, cheaper options. Good, good, good. Okay. Make sure you keep your list handy because you're going to want it as we go through the types of objections. So now we're on step two of the objection cycle. Remember, step one was listen. You've been listening carefully to your customer and they raised an objection. So now you need to identify the type of objection. So how do you do that? At Zenagos, we use the acronym PANTO, to remember five different types of objections. So we're going to go through each of the five objection types right now. So P is for price objections. When customers mention price or not having enough money, we call that a price objection. It can also come out as value, like I'm not getting enough value for this price. So more subtle price objections sound like the customer not wanting all of the features that are being offered. So some examples of price objections, that's too expensive. I can get something just as good for less. I just want something simple. All this is too much. So just look at your list and see if any of those were price objections. I can't afford it was a price objection, right? Stick a letter P next to any price objections on your list. All right, A. A is for angst objections. You can identify angst objections when customers express suspicion or a lack of trust. This can also be expressed as fear of a negative change happening in your relationship in the future. So examples of angst objections are, I've never heard of your company. You'll say it's a great warranty, but when I come in with a problem, you're not going to cover it. Or I like you, but what if you go to another company? So look at your list and see if any of the objections you had were angst objections and put a letter A next to anything that was an angst objection. Ah, I'm not sure your technology is reliable enough. That's a classic angst objection. Nice job. Okay, N is for need. When customers say they don't need the product or service at all, or they don't see how it could resolve their issue, you have a need objection. So examples are, I don't need it. I don't see how this would solve my problem, or this isn't going to get me where I need to go. So look at your list and see if any of the objections you had were need objections. And put a letter N next to your need objections. All right, T is for timing objections. So you have a timing objection when customers say they like the product or service, but they don't want it now. We definitely saw some timing objections that you put into the chat. Speed, I want time to evaluate other vendors, right? So sometimes the delay is to bring in a co-decider, one or more additional decision makers. So if you sell to individuals, B2C or business to consumer, the co-decider might be a spouse, a partner, a roommate, someone who needs to participate in the purchasing decision. If you sell to large organizations, so B2B or business to business, that can be even to nonprofits or entire countries, you may have to navigate a multi-layered structure of decision makers addressing many sets of objections. That's the kind of deal that Monica does a lot of, putting governments and airplanes and airports together. So this framework can apply to all those situations. Examples of timing objections are, I can wait until next year, or I don't need to solve this right now. I can't decide this without some additional person's agreement. Or have you ever heard, we don't have the budget right now, call me next quarter. I hate that one. So now look at your list and see, good, we're getting lots of great objections in the chat. See if any of the objections you had were timing objections and put a letter T next to your timing objections. Now, that's pretty complicated. The sales staff says that the economy is causing the product to lower the need. That's a pretty complicated one. And last but not least, O. O is for options objections. So when customers say they prefer a competing product or service, you can call that an options objection, as in, I have a better option. So your prospect might express an ideological affiliation with a competing offering, such as that car is better for the environment. So in that case, they have a commitment to some sort of belief, such as being environmentally conscious. So they're making their decision, at least in part, based on that. Or they might just prefer the overall experience of the competing option. So other examples of options objections are, this car doesn't have a digital mirror and I need that. Or I think that other car is more me. Since Mavis on our team used to sell Lexus cars, we always like to use car examples. So look at your list and see if any of the objections you typically get from customers are options objections, and put a letter O next to those options objections. Yeah, we had some good options objections in here. I want to evaluate other vendors could be an options objection. All right, so that's it. Panto, P-A-N-T-O. Price angst need timing options. Sometimes it's hard to tell whether an objection belongs in one category or another. So for example, almost any objection could ultimately be seen as a price objection. So some prospects like to haggle. The haggler might say a variety of things to keep the haggling going, but no matter what they say, it's ultimately a price objection. So if you're not certain, ask a clarifying question or choose the category that you feel is most relevant. It's not critical that you choose exactly the right label out of PANTO. What's important is that you recognize that there is an objection and that you use that as an opportunity to continue the conversation. So let's practice identifying types of objections just to increase our familiarity and fluency. So we're going to put a question into the chat and you can reply with what you think the correct choice is right there in the chat. So the customer says a warranty is a scam. The product never pays off. The company never pays off when the product breaks. Which one is that? That's right. Angst objection. Right on. All right, question two. Customer says, I don't see what your product could do for me. That's right, need objection. They say they don't need the offering, they don't see how it would resolve their issue. Okay, next question. The customer says, this is too expensive. Right, you don't get a clearer price objection than that. All right, next question. The customer says, we're already working with another vendor. Options, that's right. They have another option. Good. Next question. Call me back next quarter. Oh. That's right, that's the timing objection. Next question. This has too many bells and whistles. Ah, that one's tougher. I think the best answer here is price objection because they mentioned the value, there are too many features, but this is on the border. You could identify it as a need objection or an options objection. So if you can't tell what kind it is, you need to ask another question. Try to figure out what the core objection is here. All right, next one. The other motorboat has more horsepower. Options objection, you got it, couple more. Next question, as soon as we go with your company, you're gonna get bought by that other company that we hate. I've heard this one before. Yep, angst objection, good. Next question. Let me think about it. Yep, probably a timing objection. There could be a need objection in there. So if you asked another question, you might find that out, but that's probably a timing objection. All right, last one. This isn't gonna solve our problem. Yep, need objection. That's right. Okay, so we got a little facility with the Panto framework. This is kind of fun, right? Now you're gonna start hearing objections everywhere. So listen for them on TV, you listen for them in all of your conversations, practice identifying objections, but don't do it out loud. Some of our small business clients get very enthusiastic about identifying objections and they'll blurt something out to the customer like, that's a neat objection. This can be very confusing to your prospect. So listen to and identify those objections, but try to keep all of that excitement inside. All right. Once you've identified the objection silently in your mind, we move on to step three in the objection cycle. So confirm your understanding. This is an important step that most salespeople skip and to their detriment. You need to make sure that you fully understand the objection so that you can choose the best response. So the easiest way to confirm your understanding is to reflect back. You can do this by repeating what the person said with slightly different words and a question in your voice. For example, it sounds like you're really concerned about fill in the blank, such as, it sounds like you're really concerned about the warranty, or your top concern is fill in the blank, is that right? Such as, your top concern is safety, is that right? And you don't want to sound like a robot. So practice this until it sounds conversational. In fact, try it out in all of your conversations. You'll be surprised how reflecting back can work in almost any situation. So you'll know that you're getting good at it when people lean in and keep talking and tell you more. So be curious, ask follow-up questions. Remember, people like to talk about themselves and their concerns. So now that you can recognize objections and identify each type, you're ready to address those customer objections. So as a reminder, up until this point, you've listened well, you've noticed the objection, and you've used Panto to identify the objection, and you've made your prospective customer feel heard by confirming your understanding by reflecting back. So now, step four, address the objection. Before we go into this, one caveat. So our Panto framework at Zenagos is a technique for salespeople who are working on their skills and confidence. It's just a starting point. So once you become confident at selling and you know how to address the common objections that you get for your particular offering, you are going to naturally depart from this framework and make your own technique. And that is as it should be. Every salesperson develops a unique style for every offering. And so this framework is not a set of hard rules. It's just a launching pad. So if you find that something other than what we recommend works better for a particular objection, go with what works for you. Have confidence in your own style. And that's a sign that you're making progress in your selling. That said, in our experience, the best way to address a price objection is to either reduce scope or features or offer payment options that make the price more manageable. So the key tip here is don't drop your price without changing the offering. That's because if the price seems arbitrary, then the customer will simply not trust the value that you're offering. So you can review the features in your solution and ask which parts are less important to you. We have a client who's amazing at this, and she's an event planner. And when someone asks the estimate for the, you know, gets the estimate for the party and says, this is too expensive, she says, oh, well, open bar is your largest cost. How about going BYOB instead? Or do you want to remove the candy table? I think we could let that go. Or the photo backdrop's kind of expensive. Could you do without that? So she arrives at a price that works for the client by reducing the features of the party. In the end, the client might choose to pay the higher price in order to get specific features that they really want. Or if cost is a top priority, then they may choose that pared down offering. But either way, they see that there's value in what you offer. So if they want to pay less, then they choose the lower value. So take a minute to think about how you could address the price objections that you get from your prospects. If you have questions about addressing these objections, this is a great time to put them in the Q&A so that we can answer them at the end. All right, how do you address an angst objection? In our experience, the best way to address an angst objection is to provide testimonials or offer a guarantee. So the key tip here is tell stories of the value that you have provided to others. So remember KLT, know, like, trust. People are more likely to buy from salespeople that they know, like, and trust. If you've been a good listener and you're building a strong relationship, the prospect will begin to trust you and your offering. For newer companies that don't have a track record, a common way to reduce angst is to offer a money-back guarantee or a free trial period during which the prospect can cancel without a penalty. Angst objections can be really tough when your company's new. You just do the best you can until you have a track record and you can get some great customer testimonials. So take a minute to think about how can you address the angst objections that you get from prospects. Take some notes about addressing angst objections. All right, Julie, this is a great question. Put that in the Q&A if you would so that we don't lose it in the chat, because we will absolutely get to that if we see it at the end. The question is about how do you do a sliding scale when you have a service? All right, how do you address a need objection? The best way to address a need objection is to draw on what you learned from your conversation to emphasize how your solution meets the problem or challenge. So probe for further information so you get a sense for what their need is. The key tip here is customers buy to achieve a result. So focus on their need and the result that you're going to provide. So avoid getting bogged down in how your product or service works. Because nobody wants to hear more about how something works that they don't need. It's important to note here that sometimes a customer actually really doesn't need what you're offering. And if so, it's best to figure that out early so that you can save your valuable time and get to a prospect who's really viable. So need is the most complicated objection to address. Even very experienced salespeople can improve at addressing need objections with more practice and with feedback. Take a minute to think about your need objections. Look for those ends on your list. What could you do to address those need objections? And don't worry, we've got all these in the summary slides so that you can review them at your leisure later. The best way to address a timing objection is to offer incentives for buying right now, or to be certain that the prospective customer understands how the product is going to relieve their pain and produce a positive result. So offers like BOGO, buy one, get one, or exploding discounts like offers that have an expiration date are incentives that are designed to encourage a customer who's likely to buy sooner or later to buy right now. That kind of offer, though, is generally more applicable to retail products than to services. So you might see it a lot at your local, you know, CVS or Duane Reade or, you know, wherever you go to the pharmacy. When you have a long and detailed sales cycle, such as for a business service solution, the timing objection is an indication that you have not fully explained the value that you're going to provide. If the solution would save the customer money, then buying sooner would obviously be better and they'd want to do it. If the solution was going to increase their revenue, well, then urgency is really high because everyone needs revenue. So you haven't gotten across what the either value is that they're going to get or the losses that they're not going to get if they don't do it. So we have some very experienced and sophisticated salespeople who just say, okay, when a customer says, call me next quarter. And that may make you feel good about yourself because you're not a pushy salesperson and the customer must appreciate that, right? However, the $1 million a year salespeople stick with the conversation and they often win the business. So nice salespeople don't always finish last, but they do leave the door open for a more accomplished salesperson to swoop in and grab the deal. So take a minute to think about how you could address the timing objections that you get from prospects. Spend an extra moment on timing objections because sometimes the respective customer states an objection that you can't address, at least not right then. This one that Natalie just put in here, they feel like they need to speak to their spouse, for example. This can happen a lot with timing objections where they say they can't make a decision now because there's a co-decider who's not present. When this happens, you may have to jump off the objection cycle and schedule a follow-up. So don't forget to follow up as promised and be ready for the co-decider to introduce some new objections. We've seen some pretty creative ways of overcoming these co-decider situations. So when Mavis sold Lexus cars, she would ask the person at the start of the test drive whether there was anybody else who was going to participate in the car buying decision. And if the customer said something like, yes, my husband needs to participate, Mavis would say, well, where is he? Let's drive over there right now. So imagine how surprised the husband was to see his wife and Mavis pull up to the house in a brand new Lexus. Believe it or not, this process delighted customers and it would head off the timing objection and lead to more sales. So sometimes creativity really pays off. All right, last but not least, options objections. The best way to address an options objection is to provide proof points or share convincing data. So the key tip here is know the competition cold. Know how your features line up against theirs so that you can emphasize the strengths of your offering. So openly criticizing your competition can be a bad tactic. It actually can make the prospect aware of a competitor they hadn't thought of. And it can definitely give the prospect a negative impression of you because you're saying negative things. But it is perfectly reasonable to point a customer toward reputable news or reviews that show the shortcomings of your competition. So stay in touch with statistics and reviews that prove the value of your product or service so that you can provide them on demand. So take a minute to think about how you could address the options objections that you get from prospects. All right, that was fun. Let's take another quiz and see how well we can recall how to address each type of objection. So Stacy's going to put a question for us in the chat. Which is one good way to address a price objection? Yep, the best answer is three, flexible payment options. You can drop the price, but if it seems arbitrary, then you'll undercut the trust in the value. So you don't drop the price without also reducing the value. You can list your costs, but that can often encourage the customer to argue with you about the details, which often does not end well. Next question. All right, which of the following is a good way to address an angst objection? Number four, yes, one is tempting, and three is also a little bit tempting. But remember that you want to match what you give as an answer to what they actually objected to, right? You don't want to do answers to other objections that they didn't bring up. All right, next question. Which is the best way to address a need objection? That's right. The best answer here is to emphasize how it will solve the problem. I can see the appeal of giving a free trial, but remember, nobody wants a free trial of something they don't think they need. They also don't want a lower price for something they don't think they need. That's why it's really important to understand the objection before you give your response. All right, next one. Price objection. Good job. Good job. Number one. You guys have got that one. All right, Stacy. Next one. Timing objection. Yeah, we had to think about that one. The best answer here is to describe the positive results that you're getting for other customers. And when you get a timing objection, remember they're saying you haven't gotten across the value. Otherwise, why would they wait? So dropping the price actually isn't going to reassure them about the value. Testimonials might help. That's not a wrong answer. But in our experience, timing objections are about value and a sense of urgency. All right, next one. Angst objection. Excellent. Free trial. Next one. Timing objection. That's right. It's more applicable to products than services, a buy one, get one. But if it's something you're going to regularly buy and you're thinking about buying it later, a buy one, get one might make you buy it now. All right, last one. Options objection. Right. The best answer is two. Give stats to back up your value. When somebody tells you so they prefer the competition, it might be a disguised price objection. So you could try offering a discount to see if you got a haggler on your hands. However, in most cases, what you need to do is provide evidence that you're better than the competition. All right. Great job. Panto is an awesome framework, isn't it? Our clients really absolutely love it. And now we've arrived at the last step in the objection cycle. Step five is to confirm that you sufficiently addressed the objection so that they're ready to move forward with the sale. And this can be quick. It doesn't have to be complicated. Two questions that work really well are, does that address your concern? And how does that sound? Prospect might say, that sounds great, signaling that you are finished with objections and can ask for commitment, such as, will you pay cash or charge? Or I'll send a draft contract for you to review this afternoon. That's the ultimate goal of any sales process, to address all objections and ask for commitment. However, don't be surprised if the customer raises another objection. That's a normal part of sales. So you may go through the objection cycle multiple times, especially if you're selling a higher priced product or service. Remember, as you get practice dealing with objections, you may determine that some other response works best for your offering than the one suggested by the Panto framework. That's great. It means that you're growing out of the framework and developing your own style. At that point, you're selling your offering in the way that works best for you. It can even differ from one salesperson to another. And one last tip, don't forget the two confirmation steps. These are moments when you slow down and really listen to your prospect. These two brief steps can improve your sales conversations dramatically. Remember, objections aren't a shooting gallery. Great salespeople focus on high quality conversations and mutual benefit. If you're feeling intimidated by or anxious about selling, you can conquer these feelings with practice. So practice, practice again, and then practice some more. Start talking about your product or service to anyone who will listen to you. If your family members do not roll their eyes or run and hide when the subject of your business comes up, then you're probably not practicing enough. So let's see if we can put it all together. So for each question, we're going to look at the objection, identify it, and choose the best response. Stacy? It's too expensive. It takes a while to put it all together, isn't it? This is a price objection. The best ways to respond are either flexible payment options or lower the price while reducing what you provide. So, three is actually the best answer by asking which features are the least important. The salesperson is opening the way to offer a reduced offering for a lower price. So, the other responses might be good sales responses, but they don't address the objection, which is the price. All right, next one. A warranty is a scam. This one's a hard one. This is an angst objection. The best ways to respond to an angst objection are either provide testimonials or offer a guarantee. In this case, the best answer is one. The salesperson provides his own testimonial about the fairness of the company. This is a real life example from when I was buying a car and it worked on me, so I had to add it to the quiz. All right, next one. I don't see what your product could do for me. This is challenging, isn't it? This is a need objection. The best way to respond to a need objection is to draw on what you learned from the conversation to emphasize the result that you're going to provide to show the value. So the best answer is two, because the salesperson is emphasizing the result, reduced cost, and seeking more information to better explain the value. But I can see some love for one as well. Next one. Call me back next quarter. Good. Choice four is best. This is a timing objection and a really common one if you sell B2B. And the best way is to offer incentives to buy now or describe the positive change that you're going to provide or the negative things that will happen if they wait. Okay. I think you guys have the idea. We could practice this more. It's a really great exercise, and you can see it takes a little practice. Now we're going to walk through a couple of quick demonstrations of the entire objection cycle so that you can see the flow. So Mavis and Monica are going to do a demo. Mavis is going to be the salesperson, and Monica is going to be the customer. Mavis, take it away.
Good afternoon. How can I help you today?
Yes, I am in need of a stapler.
Oh, great. What kinds of things will you be using it for?
Well, I'm going to be preparing for taxes.
Well, this swing line on the left is our best stapler. It can handle up to 40 pages and has a really nice soft grip. It also has a rapid easy load feature, and it's $24.99. It's pretty stylish.
Ooh, $25? Talk about inflation. Let me check Amazon.
Okay, I'm in a bit of trouble. My customer is doing competitive shopping right in front of me. The objection is clearly a price objection, and I need to address it very quickly. But first, I need to confirm that I really understand the objection, so I'll ask her a question. Before you do that, how many pages do you think you'll need to staple at a time?
Oh, it's going to be about 10 or 12. I don't do much in terms of stapling.
Okay, so I just learned something. I don't need to offer her our top-of-the-line product with all the bells and whistles, and I can address this price objection by offering something a little less expensive with fewer features. Oh, perfect. Here's the right one for you. This model will staple up to 15 pages, and the price is only $9.99. Now I hand the conversation back to Monica by asking for confirmation. So how does that sound?
Now that's more of what I was looking for, so thank you.
Okay, so that's an example of handling a price objection. Maybe so to ask for commitment next with a phrase like, how will you be paying for this today? And then she would complete the sales process. So let's do another example, a little bit more complicated one this time. So Mavis, you're up again.
Good afternoon. This is Always There Home Monitoring Service.
Hi, my name is Monica, and I'm looking for an estimate for home security system. I live at 175 Main Street in Raleigh, North Carolina.
Great, Monica. We can help with that. Tell me a little bit about what you need.
Well, there's been some break-ins around here, and I want to make sure my house is safe.
So I am looking at your home using Google Maps and Google Earth. We can put motion sensors in the exterior and interior, add lighting to key areas, put sensors on every door and window, and add a professional monitoring package that will call 911 for emergencies. That will be $249 a month, plus the one-time cost of the hardware. Installation will be free.
Wow. Okay. I think I'm going to need a little bit more. I'm going to have to think about it.
So Monica has just given me an objection. I'm not sure if this is a timing objection, a price objection, or something else. So to confirm my understanding, I need to get some more information. It sounds like this is a big decision. What's your hesitation exactly?
Well, it sounds good, but maybe I should think about it a little bit more. I really wasn't ready to make a decision on this so fast.
So I've inquired, and this seems like a timing objection to me. So I'm going to see if I can address that timing objection by offering her a buy now price. Sure. So here's the thing, Monica, you called it a great time. Today happens to be the equivalent of our Cyber Monday. So if you're able to commit today, I can give you 50% off the hardware costs. And based on what I see, that could probably save you $300 to $400 if you act today. So how does that sound?
Well, gee, that sounds tempting.
So now I'll emphasize the value that we will create. Yes, and we are talking about the security of your home and family here. Every day that goes by is another opportunity for a break-in. Or worse, I could get an installation team to your house by the end of the week. All of my customers tell me that they are so happy once we've put in the system. They say it gives them peace of mind.
You know, you're right.
Great. I'll sign you up right now.
Well, about that hardware you mentioned, I have friends where the equipment just suddenly stopped working.
So we seem to have overcome the timing objection, but now she's worried about hardware failures. This is an angst objection that I have to address. Oh, I understand how having the equipment suddenly stop working would be very concerning. And that's why we have a guarantee for all our hardware, free replacement for as long as you're using our monitoring services. Our average replacement time is less than 24 hours. Does that alleviate your concern?
Yes, I'm happy with that. And the whole thing just sounds perfect.
Great. I'm going to email you the paperwork for signature, and you can give me your credit card details right now.
I should probably take some time out and this evening and speak with my partner before signing anything.
Okay, she just threw me a curveball. She won't sign without talking to her partner. And there is not a lot I can do about that. So I'm going to set a follow-up step, and I need to make sure I speak to the partner who may have a different set of objections. Okay, Monica, no problem. I'll email you the paperwork, but let's set up a call for tomorrow morning. I'd like you both to be on that call. Will 10 a.m. work for the two of you?
Yes, that should be fine.
Great. If we can get the decision before noon tomorrow, I'll still be able to provide that 50% off discount to the hardware. We'll speak to you then.
See you then.
Okay, so that demo should have given you a sense of two things. First, how the cycle of objection works. One objection can lead to another, and you have to address them one at a time. And second, sometimes you get through a few objections, and then you have a follow-up step anyway. And that's the way the ball bounces. Be great at follow-up, and you can still win the deal. You may have noticed that Mavis didn't always exactly follow the steps of the objection cycle, and things generally go in that order, but it's important not to be rigid. When in doubt, follow the flow of the conversation. So that's it, PANTO, that's our framework, and the objection cycle so that you can kind of see how it flows. That wraps up our formal presentation. So thank you for your participation. You're an amazing group, and we hope that you had some fun and picked up at least one new insight that you'll apply to your sales conversations. If you would, give us a little feedback in the chat. Did you learn anything new today about how to address objections? Does this information improve your confidence in your sales and selling? And what did you think of PANTO overall about the framework? So while you're doing that, I'm going to put up the QR code for our PDF takeaway that covers this material about customer objections. So this has summary slides. To get the summary slides, use your photo camera to grab this QR code, and then we'll email you a link so you can download the PDF of the slides. Stacy's also going to put that QR code link directly in the chat in case that's easier for you. And also, on the page that you get to when you do that QR code, there's an option to schedule a 15-minute one-on-one with Mavis. I think it's a green button. This is a free consultation. If you do schedule a session, you can share any specific customer objections that you get in your sales process, and Mavis will give you some suggestions for how to address them. I promise she won't try to sell you any consulting or anything else. She'll just help you with your, you know, personal objections questions. So thank you, everyone, for spending some of your valuable time to us today. We truly appreciate you. And now we're going to close out the presentation and get into some questions. And I see that we do have some. So the gang is all here. We call this Stump the Wizard. So this first question, for something individual like coaching, do you recommend offering a sliding scale option for price objections? Why or why not? And how best would you roll something like that out? Mavis looks like she wants to answer this.
Sure. So for coaching, individual coaching, I mean, this is very personal. So you have some particular skill, a particular knowledge, particular experience. So you obviously want to try first, if they have a price objection, to kind of distinguish yourself from their other options. You're charging, let's say you charge $150 an hour and they're comparing you to someone who charges $125. You want to be able to show why you would be different than that other choice. Now, if there's still some hesitation, and we talked earlier about reducing scope, obviously you could say, well, if you buy a package of 10 sessions, you know, maybe your per session price is lower. So you could bundle some things and try to give them a per session price that's lower. Or alternatively, you could say, you know, for 6 sessions, I think we can reach this great outcome. But if you only want to pay for 3 sessions, then we should just focus on this much smaller outcome through your coaching. So hopefully that helps give you some ideas.
There's also one other thing you can try, and that is if you usually offer an hour session, you could say, you know, you could try a half an hour session. That way they can try you out and you can charge less for the lower price for just the 30 minutes or 45 minutes or whatever seems appropriate.
And lastly, when it comes down to the sliding scale parameters, it's going to be important to make sure that you think about this ahead of time and establish some guidelines regarding that. So if it's something where there is hardships in terms of income hardships and so forth, how do you identify that and so that you have some kind of guideline for decision making around that?
There's one follow-up here about timing that someone added. So what if they tell you for coaching that they're about to go away or they're starting grad school and can't do it now, but maybe later? I've had people say they will start after vacation and they don't commit later. So one suggestion there is while you have them on the phone, schedule, book the first meeting date. So say, I understand you can't start until after you're back from vacation, but my calendar is getting full. I want to make sure you get a prime date. So let's put it in now. And it just is a little bit of an additional commitment that they're making to you.
Okay. Here's another one. I designed a solution for a prospect, but their objection is a concern that they won't be able to generate enough content to support the product. So I'll take that one because my previous business definitely required other people to create content in order for me to do the job that I was doing. This is a very challenging one. In my business, we created an infrastructure to create content for them. And so sometimes the question is, how could you make it easier for them to do the thing they need to do in order for you to do the thing that you need to do for them? So if you can't afford to build an infrastructure, then you'll have to be a little bit creative about, we'll create a schedule and we'll help you with a schedule. But ideally you create a way that they pay to have you create the content for them. Anyone else want to add on to that one? Okay. I'm an author, self-published holiday book with a plushie, and I often hear come see me in August because it's so seasonal. Any suggestions on come see me in August?
So I think one thing you could do is offer some pricing advantages for ordering early. You could also let people know that your price is planned to go to increase in August. And so if they purchase now, they will get this 2024's price instead of 2025's price. You could also try, it's a holiday book. So it's specifically about the holidays. It's not something that would apply to any other parts of the year. Maybe. I think you're going to have to just deal with the fact that you have seasonality and mm-hmm. plan for that.
You could also try a scarcity model and say, I only have whatever X number. And if you order now at this price, then I can guarantee that you'll get enough. Whereas if you wait, I might not have any left.
Right.
Is it always important to ask for confirmation on the first phone call? As a coach, I've been doing an intake meeting and then sending a proposed package, number of sessions plus fee, and then asking them to confirm. So obviously, whatever works best in your field, you should do. So if what you're doing is working and it departs from this framework, do what works. Absolutely. The framework is meant to be a launching pad. And so, it's generalized. So if something specifically is working for you, do that. And the confirmation that we do is a kind of a confirmation that you're hearing them. It's not so much a confirmation of the meeting. So it's kind of, am I hearing you correctly? How does that sound? Does that solve your problem? It's that kind of confirmation step that we use. Right. All right, I think we can probably fit in one, maybe two more. How do you offer your products and price during a bid process without knowing what they accepted unless you're the one that they accepted? Complicated question. I think this is a Mavis or a Monica. Which one of you is feeling up to it?
I can start and Monica can jump in. Mm-hmm. So with a bid process, like to a company that's sending out an RFQ or an RFP or maybe like a city, we recently got a RFQ from the city of Cambridge, for example, those processes are designed so that you don't have any visibility and you don't have access to the person making the decision. So sometimes it's pretty hard for you to go through a customer objections process with you have no data, right? All you can do really in those situations is try to kind of figure out why are they buying this? Why is it out for bid? What are they trying to achieve? Maybe you can meet someone who has an inside track, but it's pretty hard to address something when you're just shooting in the dark. Really, you're just going to be kind of wasting a lot of your time.
Yeah, and trying to give as much detail as you can give with regards to your RFP. you don't know who it's going to land on. So therefore, the more details and the more information that they have, the more, you know, the greater chance they will reach out to you. And, you know, if they need more information, then they will ask information for additional information.
Okay. I want to make sure we wrap up on time. And so I'm going to put that link back into the chat for anybody who wants to get the, you know, anybody who wants to get the takeaway. Somebody asked me, are there quiz questions in the takeaway? And there are not. But if you go and sign up for our newsletter, and I'm going to give you the link for the newsletter too, there's a checkbox when you sign up for the newsletter that says, I want the customer objections ebook. And that does have the quiz questions in it. So if you are the person who in the chat was like, I want those quiz questions, get the ebook. So sign up for the newsletter, check the checkbox, and get the ebook. And thank you again so much. And thank you, Teresa, for pulling together this great group for us. Much appreciated.
Thank you. Thank you very much for providing all the fantastic information that you do with examples so that people can learn as much as possible from this topic. So thank you everyone for joining us. Watch for the next SCORE webinar that is coming up. Watch for our newsletter. Check us out on the social media. And we'll have Zenigos back again in the future, I'm sure. So thanks, everyone.